Sorry, yes. I'm coming from Sydney, from the Kinghorn Centre of Clinical Genomics. And it's interesting because I'm going to give more or less the talk that Professor Kozaki just gave, but slightly from a different perspective. So I'm also coming from a clinical setting, and we deal with sort of the same problems. The center does only whole genome sequencing on patients, and we're also trying sort of the case study, the main case study, the main focus currently for a center is rare disorders. So in principle, as we've just said, let's put it this way. So another way of looking at the challenges with respect to diagnosing rare diseases is the fact that if you look at it from a phenotypic perspective, you may have a patient that has, you know, a phenotypic profile that includes perhaps flat back of head and hypotonia. But then if you're looking at the disorder, the level of specificity and the degree of sort of, you know, the phenotype profile does not exactly match the patient, and there may be, you know, terms that are slightly broader or slightly narrow, right? So, you know, the disease may be characterized by abnormal skull morphology or decreased muscular muscle mass. So, basically, the differential diagnosis with similar but not exactly matching terms is quite difficult. From a genomic perspective, you have to look at whole genome, right? You have, in principle, you know, in every individual around 3.2 million variants, 100 of which may very well be pathogenic. So now the question is, you see a patient, which of those variants or which combination of variants is the one that actually causes the disease, right? And the ultimate goal is to somehow, you know, put together phenotypes on one side, genotype on the other side, and somehow perhaps also the environment, if it's possible, if you're going perhaps towards sort of, let's say, common or complex diseases, and to get to this, you know, list of prioritized candidates or prioritized variants. And then you have in the middle this black box, and in the black box you have all sorts of parameters of aspects you want to look at. You know, you have pathogenicity, frequency, gene expression, gene networks, and so on and so forth. So the main question is obviously, what is it in the box, or how can we put these things together in a way in which it allows us to do to find that one or two variants that are causative of disorder. Now, as you've just seen previously, you know, a standard or a typical rare disease filtering pipeline starts from, you know, the 3 million variants I've just mentioned, and then you slowly go through, you know, 2.7 if you have good data quality, around 300,000 which are within genes, and you go down the line to perhaps, you know, 40 de novo mutations, you know, change, around, you know, 50 pathogenic, predicted pathogenic using other databases, and at the end of the day, one that is being matched in the known DB. Now, if you are to draw a line, you know, most of the processes that are, you know, on top of the red line are to some extent automated, because you can use things like the 100,000 genome project, and you can get to those, let's say, you know, 100 variants pretty quickly. But then, you know, it's all about trying to find manually what is that one single variant that causes the disease. So from our perspective and from other perspectives, you know, phenotypes are, you know, enter phenotype space, the final frontier, and I guess that picture over there, you know, sort of sums up very well this phenotype of variability. And I'm going to sort of give you a mix of both what is being used currently now, as well as some of the challenges with what is being used now and how we can get to this sort of knowledge. And I'm going to talk from a perspective of the work that is being done by the Monarch Initiative in principle. So one of the key aspects to this problem is the use of a standardized phenotype ontology. And while if you are to talk about standardization in the real sense, I don't think we have one. But if you are to talk about sort of a de facto standard for representing phenotypes, especially in the rare disorder domain, you probably talk about the Human Phenotype Ontology, which is currently has around 11,000 classes and over 100,000 manually curated annotations. And the annotations are of the form, you know, let's say Marfan syndrome, which is it's a disease is associated with arachnodactyly and ectopia lentis. Okay, now how can this help us in getting to perhaps to the matching of the patient to the disease is basically by using obviously what, you know, ontologies are best for, by using inference. And you can treat basically each of these you know, nodes as being a phenotype associated with a particular anatomical system. And then you can use the disease profiles of, or let's say, you know, you can use the disease to create a phenotypic profile by associating the disease with the different nodes in this ontology. So you end up with this bunch of nodes, so one particular disease which has a phenotypic profile, which represents basically these nodes in the ontology. And in principle, if you are to summarize it, it's something along these lines, but mapped onto several organ systems. And at the end, what you can do, obviously, matching phenotype profiles between sort of the different diseases and do, you know, semantic similarity based matching of the diseases and of the patient profile. Now, this is obviously at the high level. So if you think about the patient on the left hand side, and you know, the different diseases, basically those nodes that are being matched in the middle represent, let's say, the common set, either directly or via some sort of semantic similarity. If you are to go at the sort of lower level, what you get is a profile such as the one below, when you have, you know, craniofacial dysostosis, which is where it's present in one particular area of the ontology, and then you have a textbook description of achondroplasia, which includes, let's say, macrocephaly or large head. And obviously, what you can do by means of using, you know, HPO and the structure of HPO, you can do semantics within that ontology, and you can say, well, they are not exactly the same terms, but because it's an ontology and because I can use the structure of the ontology, I can assign a certain similarity between them. Now, one of the main challenges here is obviously getting to the data of the patient. So if you consider to some extent, while not particularly, not perfect, not true necessarily, you know, the domain knowledge being solved and well modeled, you know, you still have to get the patient phenotype data. And that's either done manually or it can be done by means of tools such as the one we've developed, which you know, uses automatic concept recognition using phenotype ontology to extract out HPO terms out of clinical summaries, which are then being used or can be used for either matchmaking or for disease prediction. Now, the second ingredient, so that's basically, that's the ontology, part, phenotype ontology part of things. The second ingredient, exactly as the previous speakers has mentioned, is basically cross-species phenotype integration, or if you are to broaden up a bit the scope, you're talking about basically model organisms, right? And you see here an example where, you know, on the left-hand side, we have zebrafish, and you have a variant in the zebrafish, which is associated with a set of phenotypes. You have a similar model in mouse, which has a different variant, in a homologous gene, and then you have a very similar phenotypic profile, and then you have a human over there, which has another variant and has yet another set of phenotypes or another phenotype profile. Now, I'm pretty sure that you can very quickly realize the fact that those three phenotype profiles are very similar, but are not expressed in the same using the same language, right? And that's simply because, you know, you have different organisms, and I'm pretty sure you're very well aware of the standard, you know, ontology mapping sort of issue. There are still different organisms, you know, and each of the organisms obviously used is being described by means of different ontologies. And this is where the Monarch Initiative comes into play. What they try to do, and they managed to do in the last couple of years, is to provide a semantic bridging across the different model organisms, across the phenotype information, phenotype space, by using the Uberon anatomy ontology and the Uber phenotype ontology. Now, just a very, very quick sort of summary. This is where the status is. As you can see, the sort of the disease is on the top side of the things, and on the sort of the phenotype on the bottom side. You can see that what they managed to do is by using both integration of both the disease as well as the phenotype ontology, more or less cover the entire space across multiple organisms. Now, in terms of clinical applications, I guess two very well sort of, I guess, known and as well as successful stories were the Phoenix and the sort of the exomizer tool that the Monarch Initiative has produced. And this is a standard example of using whole exome data together with phenotypic similarity to get to variant prioritization. And this is the pipeline used by exomizer, where you start with a couple of the standard filtering steps, which then go on to the left side of things, and then on the right side of things, you can start using and integrating phenotype information and phenotype similarities to come up with a second score. And what they did at the end basically was to combine the same phenotypic score with the standard filtering score to come up with one single score for each variant. Now, the same sort of idea can be used in a slightly different sort of manner. Again, coming back to the previous presentation, you can use it also for discovery of new disease gene associations where you don't know the gene in the patient, but you have a phenotypic similarity, and you find a mouse model, for example, that has the same phenotypic similarity, so a phenotypic profile, but has also a variant that can then be of interest in the patient. And to sum up, some of the open challenges. So if you think about, you know, phenotype ontologies, I think at this point we can say that, you know, they support improved, you know, comparison within and across across species, and they definitely enable variant prioritization, at least using whole exome data. On the other hand, we still have quite a long way to go because we have to be able to capture different other aspects of this data, like modifiers, onset, degrees of severity, and so on and so forth. Obviously, there's an imperfect coverage of the disease annotations. Some of the rare disorders are very well described, while others are not. And coming back to the last question of the previous talk, you know, data sharing is a major issue, both from a social perspective as well as from an ethical perspective. Because even if you do want to share, and even if you're talking about only phenotype terms, unfortunately, you hit yourself against all sorts of ethical guidelines, and I'm talking about this from a personal perspective within Australia, not going, you know, outside the border of Australia, but we're really talking about sort of between the states of Australia to share even such a, you know, anonymous sort of piece of information. So I'll leave with this, and I thank you very much. Thank you for the organizers for having me here.